Good day or evening to you. My name is Timothy Halloran. I am one of so many human beings currently on the planet in the 21st century. And you know, I have to admit, it's not always the funnest, easiest trip or party in the world being a human right now. And at least we're not really falling asleep these weeks. You know, this is an exciting time to be alive. There is so much potential for change. And even when there is a potential for tension, tension can be used creatively and productively. So in this video, we're focusing on a new moon in Aquarius coming up this next February 4th. And so we are now in Aquarius season. Aquarius is ruled by Uranus, which is the higher mind. We have this more objective placement, position to really see our world and our life these weeks. And so the Sun entered Aquarius last Sunday, January 20th, and Mercury soon followed, Thursday, January 24th. And today, Tuesday, January 29th, Mercury joins the Sun in his superior conjunction at 9 degrees of Aquarius. And so there is this, again, very far-seeing, objective mind. We have more of a potential for a long-range vision. While Mercury is in Aquarius, there is a more capacity to go into this analytical awareness that is progressive. This is also a more experimental, boundary-pushing mind and vision. And with the Sun and Mercury in Aquarius today, there is this, again, heightened perception. Even how we're seeing can have this greater objective awareness, which can be very useful to us at this time, because what we're going to be speaking on in the nature of these times, these weeks, the end of January, the beginning of February, is this is a major time of transition. This can feel like an in-between time, and typically in in-between times, there can sometimes be this tension, like we've said, this temporary discomfort that is oftentimes the phase in which the snake is wriggling out of the old snake skin. There are old themes and patterns being left behind, but we are not quite yet into the new and the fresh. So let's talk about Mars. We've got big Mars transits on the horizon these weeks. The 1st of February, Friday, February 1st, Mars comes into a first quarter square with Pluto. And then Mars will move on to square the moon's nodes Saturday, February 9th. So when we're talking about Mars and Pluto, we're talking about desires. Mars is our conscious, instinctual desires that we act upon. And Pluto is our deeper, more hidden, unconscious desires that tend to be more so illuminated or exposed throughout our life rather than be a conscious part of ourself that is acted upon. Well, this Mars-Pluto square can create this evolutionary tension between our conscious and unconscious desires, where our own unconscious desires can become more so exposed through the instinctual reactions that may be occurring on the surface. And again, this may be exposing the tension between our conscious and unconscious nature, which in many respects is useful in understanding, okay, this is Mars, this is our body, our energy, our drive, this is our direction, this is our goals, this is what we're setting out to do. Is Mars. Mars is like the warrior, the leader, the initiator. I'm going to go there. No one's gone there before. My gut is leading me. It's exciting. It's new. Here we go. Okay. And again, this is a conscious part of ourselves. I desire these things. I initiate this way. And then Pluto is everything beneath the surface, everything that's been repressed or suppressed since early childhood, or even going back into so many past lives. And the opportunity here is to have these unconscious desires more so exposed, which can be exposed through this creative tension between Mars and Pluto. So for example, we get an opportunity to see the distance between our conscious and our unconscious desires. Now, when we're talking about the unconscious, of course, this was largely pioneered fairly recently in our human history by Sigmund Freud and Carl Jung. And I'm a big fan of Jungian psychology. He was very early in understanding the unconscious psyche, and even though he was one of the early pioneers, he's still quite ahead of his own time. But the way in which Jung looked at the unconscious part of ourselves is it's called the shadow. Okay, and that shadow oftentimes gets a reputation for being quite scary, quite beastly, animalistic, out of control. And in the Jungian perspective, we are becoming empowered human beings by becoming aware of our unconscious and then integrating it, which can sometimes be quite a bit of a journey, and it does require courage because, again, the hidden, suppressed part of ourself, the shadow, almost takes on a separate entity form that seems separate from us because we've so redundantly swept it under the rug. And usually necessarily so. The shadow is created because there's parts of ourself that does need to get swept under the rug. We get in trouble when we're children for being crazy, wild, animalistic, for being having no boundaries, for being too brash, for being too powerful or wild. And we can't function in society just being wild women and men. And so there is this necessary conforming. And yet this also sets us up for so many problems because, again, this shadow unconscious nature doesn't just go away. And so the empowerment of understanding and doing the necessary shadow work in order to become integrated, in order to become whole, is to become empowered by being one with our unconscious nature, to be able to embrace that nature without being afraid of it, and yet not being out of control at the same time. Well, this Mars square to Pluto does not make this necessarily easy or served on a silver platter. This may be a time where we may feel more out of control, where we're having more instinctual reactions, when we're feeling angry, we're getting triggered. This is a dangerous type of transit, and I don't say that to make anyone afraid or, this disaster is doomed to happen or this type of destined disaster or fearfulness, but it's more so an understanding, we need to be aware, we need to be careful because this is the feeling of this energy can feel intense. It can feel like the sound of glass breaking or, metal scraping against metal or being dragged against gravel. It has that intensity and we can feel that in our bodies. We may be experiencing that in what's going out in the world, and that puts our nervous system on high. There is this defensive, reactive, kind of hard and brittle and closed down type of energy that we go on. Say, for example, you go to a fireworks display and there's a lot of fireworks and it's really loud. Well, we become sort of desensitized after a minute. Like at first, it's like we get shocked a few times and then, we kind of may cover our ears or close ourselves down. That happens instinctually. That happens naturally. And so we're seeing this friction happening in ourselves, this frustration between where we are and what we're doing and where we may want to be on a deeper level, or these unconscious desires that are coming in, and the unconscious is saying, what about me? I've been swept under so many times. I've got desires. I'm a powerful part of who you are. And so we're really looking at integrating these deeper desires through this exploration. And there is this need to slow down, to be patient, to not jump to conclusions, to try and channel this frustration, this anger, this hyper-triggered sensitivity, and use it constructively. Harness that passion is the gift here. Passion, ambition, to move forward in productive and constructive ways, to harness that energy and use it constructively or creatively in safe containers, or to have the dialogues where we establish the boundaries, we create a safe container first, to do a necessary experiment and exploration to understand our deeper desires, be able to align with them in a productive way that's not harming ourselves or anybody else, And this requires a great degree of patience and flexibility when the environmental factors may not be seeming to provide those things easily. We need to have more effort into creating this flexibility and this patience to not take things as seriously as we normally would. This is a temporary phase. Things may not actually be as sharp, as real, or as intense as it seems right now, and we do need to take these experiences, therefore, more so with a grain of salt. So I'm going to speak a bit more on this Mars-Pluto dynamic. This is an important transit, and really Mars is highlighted these weeks. Mars will be approaching Uranus mid-February the 13th before moving into Taurus Thursday the 14th. So this Mars square to Pluto coming up to Uranus is a very frictionous, energetic pinch. There's a lot of, again, passion, strengthened energy, very sharp, intense reverberations, because there is this evolutionary turning of a corner that we're going through in terms of our physical energy, our bodies, our sexual energy, and our deeper desires. So again, we may have exposed to us the distance between our conscious desires, what we're choosing to do, how we're aligning with our body and our sexuality, versus the deeper desires, the unconscious programming that may come from our early childhood, past lives, society, the world at large, so on and so forth. And so an example of this distance between conscious and unconscious desires, we'll say, is the good Christian. Okay, and I love good Christians, but there is a common discrepancy where oftentimes Christian people feel the need to be good because there's this huge emphasis on morality in our current religions, and all religions really, which can backfire, by the way, even though morality is inherently useful, right? Hopefully. But it should also be natural. It shouldn't be forced. It doesn't really need to be taught unless there's a problem, because it's usually common sense what morality is about. So a Christian may feel, I need to be a good Christian. This is what good Christians do, and I'm doing the right thing, and I'm being a good person, and so I'm a good person. And unconsciously, they may be feeling, I'm a bad person. I'm doing the best that I can, but I'm not perfect. I'm still a sinner. Okay, this isn't what Christianity is inherently about. It's just an example of this conscious versus unconscious reality that's very much always going on. I mean, the truth is there are hardly any human beings who are aligned with their unconscious nature. Our unconsciousness is mysterious. Again, it can be daunting in that regard because it's like the unknown. What is that beast in the closet? What does it want? You know? And of course, it's our deeper soul. Our unconscious desires go hand in hand with our evolutionary desires. And sometimes there are these complexes and knots that needs to be untangled. But we can really understand by looking at, oh, you know what? I don't feel like a good person on the inside. So one of the manifestations of this Mars-Pluto square can be the phenomenon of self-sabotage. What is self-sabotage? Why does self-sabotage happen? Self-sabotage is our suppressed unconscious nature reacting so to volcanically expose itself, so to reveal its deeper nature. So for example, good person, I'm doing good things, I'm following the moral prescription, doesn't just have to be Christian, New Ager, atheist, whatever. And then we self-sabotage, or we blow up, or we do the things that we are trying not to do, the things that we're most afraid of doing. And we become a villain to our partner, or we ruin our job opportunity, and then we reflect, why did I do this? Why did I punish myself so bad as if I deserve this? Again, it is revealing this deeper unconscious nature. Why did we sabotage this? Why did we have this reaction? Can be stemming from this deeper part of ourself. Again, the traditional perspective of the unconscious is it seems dark, scary, overwhelming, monstrous, beastly, animalistic in this regard. But what I would encourage us to see from this higher, more Aquarian, Uranian, distant perspective, this objective analytical awareness, is see the unconscious like a child. Okay. Yes, we may throw temper tantrums sometimes. We are not excused for the abuse that we cause our bodies, other people in the world. No, it's not an excuse for abuse or tyranny. But why is there this reactivity? Why is there self-sabotage? Why is there this frustration? And see this deeper, more powerful part of ourself like a child. And why is it throwing the temper tantrum? What are the symbols that are involved, right? What are the symbols involved in this reaction? What's the symbols in the job that I self-sabotage? What is the inner child throwing a temper tantrum about? Maybe it's the best job opportunity we've gotten. We're going to get a big check in the mail. We need this because we're going to do the work to make more money, to do the things we want to do. And the unconscious inner child says, hell no, I want to play now. I've been working for bigger paychecks since age 5. This has to end. I'm not getting put on the back burner forever. Me, me, me. Mars and Aries square to Pluto. What about me? What about what I want to do? I've been on the back burner forever. And this spontaneous releasing, tune into the voice from which this comes from. And we may actually be tuning into this deeper, realer part of ourself, the long forgotten inner child. No, the inner child can't just, you know, get on the speedboat and go a million miles per hour, or, you know, just start racing down the highway and cutting people off because that's what the child wants to do. There is a deeper nature that can be respected in a safe and a creative way, and this does require safe containers to discover those solutions and find those creative outlets. Okay, so again, a lot of these unconscious dynamics can go very, very far into the past. We're looking at patriarchal influence, the day and age in which we've been conditioned by for thousands and thousands of years. Women are supposed to do this, men are supposed to do this. This is what sexuality looks like. This is what good boys do. This is what bad boys do, so on and so forth. This is what success looks like. Grow up by this age, have a job by this age. These are all cultural standards that can be very limiting, very imprisoning, and can generate this type of reactivity. Mars in Aries says, let's go, let's go, let's go. Saturn in balsamic phase to Pluto says, yes, but the world, but karma, but the day and age in which we live. Not so fast, not so easy, not so simple. Okay. The opportunity is to move from anger and insensitivity to passion and creativity, from this objective awareness, this new moon in Aquarius with Mercury, Mercury in its superior conjunction with the sun today, through seeing it like a case study. See your own life like a case study. See your own experience like a mad scientist looking through an eyeglass, a telescope, a microscope. And from that more objective awareness, we can see the different pieces, the parts, and we're studying these reactions like a chemical reaction. Oh, look, A plus B equals C. When we mix a little bit of this in, we got some extra fizzling. Oh, the colors changed. Oh, there was this reaction. And therefore, we get to learn about ourselves and our relationship in a very deep, meaningful, and profound way. And we can find the creative solutions to integrate into our power, our body, our sexuality. Yes, they all go hand in hand, believe it or not. And these is a way of becoming integrated human beings, therefore capable of creating change in the world, catalyzing transformation. That is the opportunity of this Mars-Pluto square, if we can be flexible and be willing to get down to business. So that was the Mars-Pluto spiel. Now let's move on to Venus, because Mars isn't all. Venus has been on a Sagittarian adventure this last month, and from January 20th to 22nd, Venus was square to Neptune and then conjoined Jupiter. So this last couple weeks, there's this opening, this expansion in relationships. What can we be doing together? What new philosophies are we discovering? What new adventures can we be going on? But it is an exploration. It's been a very far-seeing, long-term, many, many steps ahead, and maybe many steps ahead of ourselves type of journey. And this has just been setting this long-term exploration. And with Venus, there can be sometimes this, okay, now we're getting back to reality. You know, Venus still wants to break free, still wants to explore. There's this exciting dynamic of discovering our deeper values, our hearts, what we cherish, and how to share this with other people in this open-ended adventure, in this exploration. This experimental quality is part of what takes us to the light at the end of the tunnel again. Now, Venus is going to come up and square Chiron Sunday the 3rd and move into Capricorn the same day. So there is this getting back to reality theme here, okay? We're kind of making it real. Like, we've been on this very exciting journey the last couple weeks. New doors, new potentials, and it's been an exploration. We're discovering our deeper dreams and goals in the long-term way. And now there's a need to make it real. And sometimes this, oh, getting back to reality, oh, there's work to do, oh, there's this hump that we are going over a hump. Let's face it, the first weekend of February, we are going over a hump. And, you know, I don't like to sugarcoat things in these videos. So, you know, this is a journey. And part of this distance between our goals, our dreams, and where we are now, the work that we have to deal with now, the nitty-gritty details, sometimes it can create this sense of hopelessness or, oh, it's not worth it, or it's too hard, or there's such a vast distance that I just want to give up. This Venus square to Chiron can bring up themes of isolation in relationships, loneliness. We can be reflecting on past relationship dynamics. That's a big key here. If we're feeling this isolation, this loneliness, if we're having tension with our partners or our close friends, or there's this sense of disconnect, through this case study lens, be observing, how is this a reflection maybe of past relationship dynamics that's being reviewed, that's being triggered? Because sometimes when we're reviewing old wounds or having it revisited, it seems like we're moving back into the past, or we're losing something. We're not actually losing something here. We're discovering what we value more, what makes us who we are. And part of these past experiences has shaped us to be who we are. Sometimes not being able to just open up and share what we love and have that understood and met by others is reflecting back to us who we uniquely are, not in a way to give away our treasure or to give up, but to honor and to cherish what that is. Okay, this is what I value. Okay. This reviewing of old wounds and themes is really a part of cleansing it. And we've got this big, big Chiron transit shifting out of Pisces into Aries, February 18th. Chiron has been in Pisces since 2011. So this next month, there's this Chironic tying up of loose ends that is related to the healing journey, the reconnection with our sense of innocence, the spiritual journey, the sense of being connected to something bigger than ourselves. Venus square to Chiron is going to review some of the wounds, some of the past relationship dynamics that may have created the sense of disconnect or loss of innocence or purposelessness or aimlessness or feeling empty or feeling void. Again, this is a cleansing of the wound in order to come into a regained sense of purpose and confidence. Now, with this Venus square to Chiron, some of the instinctual response to this dynamic can be to close ourselves off, to guard our hearts because we've been hurt in the past. I got hurt. This hurts me now, so I'm going to retreat. I'm going to hide. And this is somewhat natural. And so again, with the case study, we can be aware of these dynamics, not beat ourselves up that we want to retreat, but understand why. Ah, the inner child is feeling this or that. I can provide this to the inner child. I can hold this emotional container for the inner child. This is what the inner child is asking for. If we can keep our hearts open, if we can embrace the friendships, the associations that are at least open and willing to listen to us, if we can embrace that, opening up and sharing our experience at this time can be very healing. Our interactions can be very informative. The mirror of relationship can give us access to this deeper healing journey that is taking place. And so again, let's face it, early February is a bit of a hump between this Mars square Pluto, Venus square Chiron. There's a lot that's getting swept up from beneath the surface and it's getting rinsed. And there sometimes is this feeling of discomfort. The snake is wriggling out of the old snake skin. But the amount of potential to let go of the old themes, the old patterns, the old addictions, It's like we let go of an addiction when it becomes enormously tasteless. And oftentimes addicts are clinging on to addictions even though they're not fulfilling, because there's some other void, there's something else that's missing. The addiction itself is not the source of the wound or the problem. So we're having the deeper wounds, the deeper sources illuminated at this time. That can be extremely uplifting, healing, and progressive in a deep and productive way. But we, in having these deeper wounds, it's just like, wow, this addiction is really tasteless. It's not enjoyable. I keep running off, and running away makes me feel worse. This coping mechanism makes me feel worse. This hiding tendency makes me feel worse. This suppressive tendency makes us feel worse. Mars and Venus deal a lot with the body. We're really looking at the body these weeks. You know, my health is not feeling perfect, and it's connected to this deeper theme. For example, in myself, I'm having food stuff come up, and it's just like, wow, I'm having a hard time eating and feeling good in my body, and it's connected to these deeper issues going into childhood and the past and emotions, so on and so forth. But the body is really sending the message right now, like, I don't feel good, you know, this is what's needed, this is what's lacking, and we can really tune into these things to find the connections, the missing links that are tied to these deeper, more big issues, that when we turn the spotlight onto the shadow, when we turn the spotlight onto these deeper, more hidden parts of ourselves, that's when the real change happens. That's when the real transformation happens. That's where we can rewrite our whole life in a way where we can be tremendously empowered and have a whole new self-identity in terms of who we are and what we're here to do. So that's the opportunity. So let's come full circle back to this new moon in Aquarius. Again, this is coming up February 4th, 4 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Now, this is a pretty beautiful new moon, all things considered, even with the tense Venus, Mars, transformation, creative opportunity going on. This new moon is at 15 degrees Aquarius, conjoined Mercury and sextile to Jupiter. And so there is this real opportunity to progress. Again, this higher vantage point, this higher mind, this objective awareness can really be going for us through this next month of February. But also Aquarius deals with connection. There is an opportunity to expand into new connections, keeping our heart open. If we can be vulnerable, that's the challenge, that's the medicine, particularly with the transiting North Node in Cancer, being emotionally vulnerable. If we can be vulnerable without being mean, and this is tricky when Mars is square to Pluto, we don't realize how tense and how mean we may be subtly coming off. Even if we're trying to be vulnerable, if we feel this tension in our body. So it's like we really have to master relaxing ourselves, slowing down, checking into that higher awareness, relaxing enough to be vulnerable, to share what's going on in the inside in a way that's not going to infect or harm or trigger other people that are going on around us. If we can do that, we can benefit so much from the social connections and sharing that are going on these weeks. In fact, this new moon sextile to Jupiter is this huge opportunity for social sharing and connection that can benefit the social good, that can be in some charitable, humanitarian type of movement, or generating resources by being involved in big groups, doing your online sharing, can generate an income, can generate money, or bridging social humanitarian work with our sharing, with what's benefiting ourselves and generating an income. My goodness, that would be a win-win. What's not already perfect and done can inspire innovation. That's the key with Aquarius and his ruler, Uranus. I like to associate the phrase divine discontent with Uranus and Aquarius. It's like, yeah, where we are is okay. We're getting by. We're scraping by with this Mars Pluto, but we are getting by. You know, we're eating, we're paying the bills, the kids are fine, the family's fine, but you know, it could be a lot better. We could be so much more evolved. We could be so many centuries in the future. My goodness, humanity could be in a totally different place. We could be centuries in the future. We could be interconnected with nature. That's this divine discontent, this divine restlessness of Aquarius. We can harness that innovative, pioneering urge to make things better. Things are not already perfect, which means we live in a reality which can constantly improve. This is one of the deep spiritual wisdom teachings that I love to focus upon, because we tend to beat ourselves up in this given day and age with our moral instructions, with our expectations for perfection, which at this particular time, let's face it, no human being is perfect. We're doing the best that we can, and that effort is what counts. Us putting in the effort, Jeffrey Wolf Green, the founder of evolutionary astrology, that's what fuels evolution. That's what makes things better and better forever. So things aren't already perfect, because things can constantly improve, as far as I can tell, eternally. Let that sink in. That's something in which the so-called hell of imperfection becomes a hidden blessing, becomes the path to heaven itself. It's an incredible paradox. It's something we can chew on now through the rest of our life that can take us into some of the deepest wisdom of love, a surrender, and spiritual reality. So this new moon in Aquarius wants to push on boundaries, wants to break down imprisoning realities. This divine discontent makes an increased awareness of limitations. That higher perspective awareness brings an awareness of limitations. You're stuck in this box. I can definitely see you're stuck in this box. And you're missing all of these things outside of the box. So this higher awareness, this divine discontent, can help us push on boundaries, break out of any limiting prisons, break out of any imprisoning realities, thoughts, ideas, or mental constructs, limiting situations. This next month is going to really expose these limiting situations that we want to break out of. The key is absolutely patience. Okay, it's not all perfect today. It's not all perfect tomorrow, but it's one baby step after the next. If we go too fast, we end up tripping over ourselves, and it's a setback. So one breath after the next, one step after the next, one puzzle piece after the next, the whole picture can come together. We need time for both reflection, and we need time to experiment with and how to catalyze change. In needing time for both, we have to be flexible, okay? It's not the time to initiate change or to go full bore right now. It's time to reflect. You're feeling crazy. You're feeling emotional. Slow down. Get a snack. Get a nice meal. All right, we've been stuck in anger and frustration, and we've just been naming all the people on our hit list. Maybe it's time to do something else. Maybe it's time for a change. Use that anger, that frustration, to do something positive. We need to respect our bodies these weeks, this next month. And tuning into our bodies, we can learn what it is that we uniquely need to be empowered. Our body sends us so much information about who we are that we've been culturally trained to set to the side, because there's work that needs to be done. You got to pass your spelling bee. Okay, so let the body inform us. And again, there's this extra capacity to connect and network with those who are aligned with this deeper work in ourselves. Again, the win-win is, you know, I'm struggling with this. I want to get there. I'm not there yet, but my soul's desire is to get there eventually. Let's share our frustration with those who can at least reflect back through that distant third-party objective awareness where we're actually coming from. That's the other way to do Aquarius, is we get that objective awareness through others. And we can also align with like minds who value similar things as ourselves, who are dealing with similar frustrations, and then we join together. Then we don't feel as isolated. We don't feel as frustrated. We feel empowered by identifying this is the work. This is what we're doing. And even if we're just doing one little thing a day aligned with this good work, it's going to pay off. It's going to take us forward. It's going to introduce whole new realities, whole new dimensions of possibility. That's the potential with Uranus and Aquarius, introducing fundamentally new realities by breaking down the very conceptual barriers, so to introduce new dimensional possibilities. So, I'm wishing all the best to you. It's an exciting time to be alive. Stay cool, stay calm. I look forward to talking to you in a couple weeks. I'm going to get back to my Patreon community this month. Super excited to do so after taking a quick break in January. Some of the networking and sharing I'm going to be doing through my Patreon community at the link below. For those who want extra astrology resources, want to share their chart or connect with others, it's a great platform to do so. I also offer readings and workshops through my website at the link below. And we're doing part two of the complete course for evolutionary astrology. If you want to learn about planets, This entire course is on planets. So myself and the New Paradigm Astrology Dream Team are putting together this course. It's set to begin that first week of February, so check out details at the link below. And again, wishing all the best to you and your beloveds. And please do remember to breathe and take care.